Hi, very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I think this is the last panel discussion for the day. Abhishek set the context well. Thank you for that. I'm sure there were a lot of questions, but I wonder why they were not asked. All right. Or maybe there was just a lot of confusion about the product, and I don't know. But continuing from there, I think we're a small panel, and I think what we'll do is take this discussion slightly differently. Instead of waiting for questions later, basis what we've spoken about, if the audience today feels like asking any questions, you can ask it right away as to what is it that you want to hear about, because the topic is quite open. It talks about technology in solar. So if there are any nagging questions that you already have, and we have quite an eminent panel with four different people from four different backgrounds, we'll try and answer those questions. And if you're not able to, maybe we can write back to you. So any nagging questions that you have or anything that you would like us to address, we can mold the session accordingly. Any questions of that sort? Sure, sir.
Yesterday we heard that there is a possibility of 23.6% efficiency. Mm-hmm. About 2 years back, I read in the literature that Panasonic has developed 27% efficiency panels in the lab. I am not sure whether they have become commercial yet. And one of my friend who has worked on solar cells earlier, he says that there is a technology existing which can be put to practice and get conversion efficiencies of up to 60%. 60%. This appears to be a, I don't know what to say. How do you think technology to progress and estimate, yeah, what is the limiting efficiency in future which we can achieve? In theory, many times, for many subjects, I have worked on many topics, so we have some inherent limits of practical conversion of various parameters. Yeah. So is there any parameter which is limiting the conversion efficiency of solar cells,
right,
which probably we might be able to overtake in a few years' time?
Sure. So we get your question. If you could just introduce yourself for the benefit of the audience.
Sorry, I didn't remember. I am Dr. K.C. Mittal. I worked in BARC and recently I retired, and I am doing sort of some consultancy in solar area these days.
Sure, Dr. Mittal, thank you for your question. Any other questions before we start the discussion? Okay, great. So I think that's the only thing that this audience wants to hear about, so then the panel is free to talk about anything that they want to. I think what we'll start this panel with is a round of introductions. I think, Bhuwan, you can start off.
Good evening. My name is Bhuwan. I'm from Jinko Solar. I'm taking care of West Zone of India for Jinko. And let me give a brief introduction about Jinko, how we are doing it and what we are actually bringing up on the table for the people. So for Jinko, we are number one in the world for capacities and quality as of today, as per Bloomberg. And this year also, we are able to retain that position from Bloomberg. I mean, it is not published yet, but yes, it is already declared internally. So I would just like to put it up on table that, yes, it is very much there with us. So we have roughly around 10 gigawatt capacity as of today, in which we are majorly focusing on mono cells and development of mono cells, even of mono PERC to be very precise. Looking at the kind of change coming in the market, kind of requirement coming in the market, we are talking about space, we are talking about area, I mean how to minimize it. So we are trying to develop ourselves to more toward a mono or the technology which will help it. So we came up with bifacial, half-cut cell, mono PERC. So we are trying to develop ourselves into it. And this year, in I mean, to give a comfort, a lot of people have it in mind that, okay, it's a Chinese firm. I don't know how much time will it stay with you. So just to give a comfort on that, now we are very much an Indian identity. We have registered ourselves in India. We are very much there with a fantastic team of 20 guys with post and pre-sales technical, which will help you across before buying and after buying. Whatever the issues comes in, we are there to help you out. And we are coming up with godowns, warehouses in India. So we are not here to sell it and go away. We are here to be with you for a longer time, for 25 years to say.
Thank you. Thanks, Bhuvan. Sachin, if you could introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Sachin Agarwal. I'm representing Godrej. Now, a lot of the peers sitting in the audience would be amazed that what Godrej person is doing on the panelist. So just to give you a brief about the Godrej, we are a 120 years young company. We are few of the companies in India who has committed that 25% of our power will come from renewable. So predominantly it would be 40 megawatt our own internal requirement, and which majority will come from the rooftop solar. We had started our solar vertical division primarily to cater to our internal needs. But as a Godrej, we touch 60% of Indian population daily in their daily routine life. So we keep on getting feedback from our customers that why as a Godrej you are not coming up with your own vertical which will cater to the external clients. Why you are doing solar installation only on your house offices or on your own buildings? Then 2 years back we started giving services to external clients. We had recently touched close to 100 external installations in rooftop. Whenever we go in, means everyone talks about the prices in the earlier discussion. But we are the ones who choose our customers. We don't believe in L1, L1, L1. As I had raised the question that we talk about the value one. What value we bring to the customer. We are there for last 120 years. We are going to be there for another 120 years. So it is up to the end customer what he wants. Yep, thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Kapil Kumar and I'm heading the technology team of Fortum. Just to tell you a little bit about Fortum, Fortum is a Finnish utility and we have started operation in India in 2012 and till today we are operating like 200 megawatt plus in a different states.
That was a quick introduction before I could finish my mentors. I'm Abhay Tilwankar. I lead the analytics team at Mahindra Susten. Analytics is a part of the O&M SBU, so we take care of plants after they're built. And the range is from 5 kilowatt all the way to about 200 megawatt. So we do maintenance for all the sizes practically. In terms of the company, I think Mahindra Susten established in 2011 and today it's over 2 gigawatts in terms of installation. In terms of O&M, we are about 1800 megawatt that we are operating. We've seen the entire solar journey, right from the NSM phase one, etc., where tariffs were 18 rupees all the way to sub 3 rupee tariffs. And I think it's been an exciting journey and we're pretty confident the next few years will be even more exciting as we talk about technology, as we talk about automation and the whole digital revolution that India is seeing, not just in solar, but even simple things like buying milk or coffee. So I think that's my background. And in terms of the way the session goes, I think we'll start with Dr. Mittal's question on modules and what's the kind of limitation of modules, etc. And since Bhuvan is from Jinko, maybe I'll ask Bhuvan to start this conversation on what are the latest technologies in modules. Of course, we saw the Wari presentation on AC modules, but then what are the cutting edge technologies and probably what is the upper cap in terms of efficiency for modules?
Okay. So as far as Wari, what they have presented, it's AC side. So let me be very clear on that. We are not going AC as of now. We are working on the normal DC and because it's the most efficient technology till we have seen and it's on ground. So, okay, let me come ahead with the question of Dr. Mittal. Sir, you have asked about the efficiency, which we are talking about like 23%, someone is saying it is achieved in labs, or 18, 19, 17%, which is there in the market. So that's true. I mean, 17, 17.5, 18% is something which is very much there. If you talk about mono and mono perc, when it goes up to the output of 365, it's very much 18% plus. Even I can say that because we are using it for our own 1.5 gigawatt, which we are doing in Abu Dhabi. It's completely 1.5 gigawatt with mono perc 365 watt peak. So that is one of the showcase project for everyone across the world that, okay, mono perc can be so sustainable. And there were the myths that, okay, with mono perc, there are some losses, major losses. So we want to cut it out of that. And about 23%, sir, that's actually there. That's very much there in labs. It's not that it is not available on the earth, it's very much there, but still it is into laboratories and it is into R&Ds or with the higher, the buyer who want to go, yeah, please, sir. Oh, okay. sorry, I have not noted 27%, I have taken 23% because I have...
27% Panasonic has demonstrated in their labs. 2 years back, I read it, sometime in March only. So I am not sure what is the status on commercial side from Panasonic. Nobody else may be working on that, I'm very sure.
Sir, I think Panasonic are the right people to reply on that. But 23% or 25%, I can say it is very much available and commercially not that easily available because of the high price, to be very precise.
Right, that's okay.
Yeah.
Just to add one point, I mean, in lab scale, the efficiency has been approved more than 30%. The tandem junction modules are available. There are some kind of modules which are like a crystal where light comes, does not go out. So, and in space applications, modules are getting, mono modules are getting used at a higher efficiency from a long time. Now, in space applications.
I know that space, their efficiencies are not very high.
Those efficiencies are higher than these conventional what we're talking about. So, and those in space application, these are getting used. Now, what happened in the industry earlier, polycrystalline, we used to dominate the market. Now, the time has come for look like mono will dominate the market. Earlier, the rise in the efficiency in the polycrystalline has been low compared to the mono, but the price drop has been drastically lower compared to the mono. Now, with the new technologies in the monocrystalline, mono perc, it looks like that their prices are also coming similar to the polycrystalline. So mono perc, which looks like that, could dominate the market in a year or two.
So just to add a point on the Panasonic module, the technology is HIT, on the basis of which they're claiming that efficiency. And that's something that we can probably connect later and we'll share you some write-up over it. I haven't heard of that being commercially available, but unfortunately I'm not on the procurement side, but then I could connect you with somebody on that side to answer your question.
Thank you.
In terms of inverters, I think Kapil, since you're the head of technology for Fortum and I'm sure you're dabbling with inverters on a daily basis, I think one of the questions that the industry has been asking for the last 2 years is the string inverter better or is the central inverter better? That's a constant question. And today we've heard about micro inverters, so let me add micro inverters as well to it. Which is better, micro inverter, string inverter, or central inverter? And Sachin, you're free to add to it. It's a question which is for the both of you.
Actually, it depends whom you're asking, you know. If you're asking to the EPC, the question, EPC or the supplier, the answer will be totally different. And if you're asking to the developer, for us, the problem is that whenever we evaluate string inverters versus the central inverters, it's definitely sure that string inverters are giving a higher energy gain compared to the central inverters. But when you talk about the balance of subsystem cost, passing on from the EPC side, that is not there. So sometimes it becomes very tough to choose for existing inverters. So developer like us, we believe to go on the central side and we go ahead and place the orders over there. But nowadays they are a little bit, I mean, I understand that new companies like Goodbee, Huawei, they are pretty aggressive in the market. So I hope that existing inverters could take a bigger market in future. But in the large utility scale, existing inverters is still quite lagging behind. Micro inverters is pretty much new. So as I told that, these are a kind of optimizers which has to still get proven in the market, you know. And maybe good for a rooftop application, but large scale utility, I'm not sure.
Thanks. Sachin, your thoughts?
Yeah, I'm having a different view. I wear two hats in Godrej. One as a developer for my internal projects and one as a EPC vertical head. So for my, in fact, we are coming up with biggest rooftop projects in a single campus of 16 megawatt that is close to Khalapur. The phase one would be of 3.2 megawatt. So here this question has come to me, whether we should go for a string inverter or a central inverter. I had done my own internal due diligence and I had okayed a string inverter. It is basically more from the system reliability. When I'm going to go in a going for a war, I want to use the best ammunitions and machinery with me, which are more reliable in nature. So I choose a string inverter. When I'm pitching as a EPC, depending upon the kind of the budget approvals is there with the customer, we pitch in with the central inverter. Now the just one thing to add, micro inverters. So again, this is a disruption in the technology, I should say, where probably we are going to eliminate our central inverter or the string inverters, but I am going a way ahead of micro inverters itself. I am looking for a scenario where the module manufacturer will come with a module which will not give you the DC power, but with the AC power, having the inbuilt inverter in the module itself.
Sure, thanks for your thought.
Just add one more comment. Okay, see, with the string inverters, we can see there are 2-3% energy gain compared to the central one. But again, the problem is that now central inverter sizes are getting increased quite in a big way. Now, I still remember in 2009 and 10, the inverters were 250 kilowatt, maximum 500 kilowatt. Now we are talking about 3.15 megawatt, 5 megawatt inverters. So when this kind of size increase happen, I'm not sure whether string inverters will give a better cost economics.
Thanks, Kapil. Quick poll to the audience. How many of you think string inverters are better? Not sure. I just want to see a quick hand. So I think 1, 2, 3, 4, about 10 people think string is better. How many people think central is better? Just one. Oh, so in a hall with 90 people, if 11 people think either of them, what are the others thinking? Any thoughts? Well, how many people think micro inverter is the best? Oh, good. You have 4 people in the audience who feel the same. That's all right. No, I agree. So this is a technology session where we are not talking about cost as of now. No, that's great. I mean, good to hear an opinion. I'm sure the rest of you who did not raise your hands are still not sure which is better. Don't worry. There's a big percentage of the solar industry which is also fighting, like we just saw on the stage here. In terms of my views, I'm kind of giving you an O&M perspective of central versus string. If you look at central inverters are quite complex, where you would have SPDs, you would have fuses, you would have a lot of electronics, firmware, and a lot of other complex things going on in there in terms of a layman. Vis-a-vis a string inverter is quite simple. The biggest advantage of string inverters is it's plug and play. So tomorrow, if let's say a 300 kilowatt inverter has failed, all you have to do is tell anyone who's been trained at basic inverter replacement to go in there, replace it, and get out. So your system availability can be quite high if you go in for a string inverter. The other thing that Kapil was talking about is the generation gain. Well, in terms of generation gain, I would say it's predominantly because of lesser losses, better MPPTs, lesser cabling, etc., which leads to that generation gain. And then it completely depends on how your plant is laid out, what is the size of your plant to actually see that kind of a gain. It could so happen that you put in a string inverter and you don't see any gain at all. In terms of another difference between a central and a string inverter is, if you go in for a central inverter of, let's say, a 5 megawatt capacity, which I don't think is commercially available, but let's imagine it is tomorrow, you would need string monitoring boxes. You would need special hardware which can actually read what is the string current. In a string inverter, you actually have a smaller capacity connected and it gives you a higher accuracy of data. So in terms of overall, I think that's the key differentiator in terms of string and central, as per my opinion goes. So that's, and I still am in that 90% category where I'm not convinced which one to choose. It's only after I get the details of the site location, how the array layout looks like, what is the budget available, what is the level of detailing that we want to get into, that we will be able to make a right decision on whether string is better or central is better or microinverter is better. So that's the summary on the inverters. I think in addition to just the module and inverter, which probably account for 50 to 60 to 70% of the cost, there are other factors which come into play, right from your structures to probably technology in the way you're piling, the way you're making your drawings, the way you're cleaning your module. So there's a lot of other technologies which are available in the market. And I think the panel has quite some experience on that. And if you'd like to throw some light on technologies that have touched your company, or you know, you've been a part of some technology journey, I'm sure the audience will benefit from them. And the floor is open. You could start, whoever's.
Balance of system, it is one of the things that we keep on talking, that it is one of the very neglected area in the entire supply chain. And I had seen a lot of photographs in the past where we had seen that a storm has come and the modules has blown away, and then on the switchgear side there is a burning issues which has come up because of the workmanship and not so trained personnel at site. We are typically, as a company, we are predominantly into rooftop. So on the structure side, we are doing a lot of evaluation currently. The one such structure that has come to us is the Bosmac, which is having the high resistance to corrosion, and again it is from a brand. So we are under the evaluation, and we are seeing that a lot of innovation is going to come up on the balance of supply system also. Again, on the we are seeing the FRP material which is coming up in a big way. So everyone, whether it is the developer or the EPC player, they have to keep a close watch on the innovations which are coming up in the market. And don't think that the innovation is going to come up from a big companies only. Last 1 year, I had discussed with lot of startup companies who are bringing up this kind of innovations and changes in the system. Basically, with being the big corporates, we are giving the startup companies as a platform to come and showcase their innovations, their products. And in fact, we are testing this kind of products in our small rooftop installations.
Great. Sachin, if I could just ask a follow-up question there before I lose this thought. You mentioned very interestingly there are a few startup companies which are in this space. I would love to hear about what are the spaces that they're in, what kind of technologies are we talking about, because I think the audience would love to hear something interesting, because it's a very, very interesting point that you raised. And you can avoid mentioning the name of the company, that's fine.
There are companies who are coming up with a fuel logic controller. Let's say the integration of 4 to 5 different technologies, and then giving an option to the end customer, which from which supply source they want to procure the energy. So this is one area. The second area is on the analytics part. Probably the startup companies, they are not that good on the analytics, but definitely what I seen or what I had come out is they are good on the hardware side. Probably their guys needs to be trained on what needs to be done on the analytics part. So this is the second area. Third thing which I'm seeing a big opportunity for the startup companies, the operation and maintenance, which is one of the most neglected area. And the fourth thing, which in fact I had, during the lunch hours I had just spoken with one of the guys, the retrofitting, which is going to come up in a big way in India. Right now we are, because of the cost, we are just coming up, putting up the plant, and everyone sitting on the dais and maybe my peers, everyone knows that after 4 to 5 years, there is a big market for retrofitting, which is going to come up. So that would be a good space to be in.
Thanks. Kapil, I'm sorry I cut you short.
If you talk about on the utility side, so in utility side, there are one area where a lot of improvement has happened, that to do the pre-feasibility of the site. Earlier, people used to go on the site and walk full site area and then try to see what are the risks related to the feasibility of the site. Nowadays, there are companies exist who are ready to provide you data either by doing a drone survey or then you are pretty much able to make your layout by yourself in the office itself and able to find it out which are the areas where the installation is not feasible. So those kind of new and these kind of innovations are also helpful to carry out a prudent operation and maintenance, like finding the hotspots in a module. Just take a one drone survey done and you can easily identify it, whether strings are not working or is there any fuse are blown or there are hotspots in the panel. So I think that's the one thing. Now, if you talk about block size, I think block size is already pretty much has gone pretty high. It used to be 2 megawatt. Now we're talking about 10 to 12 megawatt. It may happen in the future that this could go up to 15 megawatt, but it all depends what kind of inverter size comes in the market. What I heard recently that people have started exploring the windings of the transformers as aluminium windings. So I don't know whether those are proven or not, but again, these are the areas where people are trying to optimize. But just to tell as a developer, in the BOS side, there has been already quite a drastic change from the cost perspective. If you did look about 5 years before and today, there are very very limited optimization which are left out. The bigger optimization may come through the module or the inverter size. That what people should to look after. Otherwise, there are chances that people will start compromising on the quality of the project.
Thanks, Kapil. Interesting. Your thoughts, Bhuwan?
I'm good with the people because they are more.
My one question to Kapil, yep. Because I need to understand from him. You talk about the pre-feasibility report through drones. How much reliable is the outcome from the drone survey for, let's say, for the estimation of the related to area grading and how much cutting and filling that you need to do?
You can get data up to 5 meter accuracy. So it's like it's pretty much, and you can do on the desktop. So there are a lot of work which you can do it before even you move to the site. Whenever you get a blank site, your team goes over there, then you start making the points for the piles and other things. These could be done even much before. So this will help you to reduce the overall construction time as well as able to, I know, because of this price war, actually we are not in a price war, so that's a different thing. But again, in this price war of the tariff in the utility side, a lot of time people ignore the land risk. So these kind of new companies coming, there are certain regulation issues about the drones. I don't know what is the status over there, but I'm aware there are a couple of companies who are offering these kind of services, and that may help to improve the quality of the projects in future.
Thanks, Kapil. So I actually agree with Kapil on the automation of the entire site survey. Not just drone data, but satellite data as well is available today, which is being merged with the drone data to come up with a really realistic report on not just site grading, etc., but also on the drainage design and all the other environmental factors that can come in. And
if you see in Karnataka, recently government of Karnataka has done one flight. They have taken the flight operation in the whole state, and they are able to identify each and every roof. So very soon they are going to publish the area of all different roofs exist in the whole Bangalore city. So those kind of digitalized information are going to help all the developers to plan their business in future.
Precisely. And I just felt that there are a lot of other things that are worth mentioning. So I've just jotted down the entire BOS and the value chain. I'm trying to touch upon each of them. So starting with pre-feasibility, which Kapil has already covered, there are automated tools available which can do your design automatically once you've entered the latitude, longitude. You've entered what kind of configuration you want. The design is generated automatically. I think Aurora Solar is one of those companies which does it. In terms of structures, there are companies which have automated piling and automated concreting and automated structure installation. So Alion Energy is one of those companies which does this. When it comes to structures, there are also companies which are talking about trackers and both single axis, dual axis, 1.5 axis. So there are all of these trackers which are almost plug and play. I'm sure you've heard of the Mahindra tracker, but then this wasn't mentioned for the plug. There are companies like Next Tracker, Scorpius, and a lot of companies which are available today who've made tracker installation really simple and you need no grading. Coming to inverters, there are inverter containers available today where the inverters are already installed, the transformer is already installed. You just need to ship the inverter container, position it, connect it, and it's ready to commission. In terms of control rooms, there are, like I said, containers which are available, which are ready to be just installed, and you have PV structures which are with much better ventilation and cooling systems. In terms of the entire site progress activities, there is complete automation which is available right from the day that your proposal has gone and has been accepted all the way to the commissioning of the plant. And Mahindra for one has a software of this sort which enables the customer to transparently see what is the stage of the project right now. In terms of site security, drones are being used. There are video analytic cameras which can detect who's coming in, who's going out. You can configure who are the kind of people who you want to allow. So let's say I'm a crook, I'm not supposed to get into that site. I can configure, let's say, Sachin's face and he's allowed in, but the moment I walk through, there's an alarm and I can be intercepted. There are also cameras and the sort of Vuzix and Google Lens which can be worn and you can detect. I mean, the Chinese are trying it out with their traffic police system where the cameras in their glasses are automatically scanning the number plates and the people who are crossing them to see if they have any offenses. So there's a lot of technology that is coming into play even in security. Module cleaning, again, a very big source of drop in generation, drop in your IRRs, etc. There are a lot of robots which are out there in the market. There are a few new ones which will be launched soon. So right from Ecopia to Solbright, Sunbrush, all of these companies are out there in the market. You should definitely explore them, if not buy them. In terms of maintenance, SCADA is really, really crucial to the way you operate your plants. And there are a lot of good SCADAs which are available today, which allow you not just to do monitoring, but also allow you to generate reports automatically, understand why your plant is not performing, do the analysis, and give you the outputs. Machine Pulse is one. There are other companies like, I think GE is there. You have also, you have Locus. So you have a lot of players out there which are providing you good quality SCADA. In terms of O&M, I think drone was already mentioned for hotspot detection, but you also have fixed wing aircrafts which can be used for hotspot detection. And when I say fixed wing aircraft, I'm talking about both the smaller sizes, which will probably be the size of this table, but there are also companies which are using full blown aircrafts to do drone thermography, where they're covering 500 megawatts in a matter of 3 to 4 hours. In terms of water, what used to be a trend of 2 to 3 liters per module to clean, today we are talking about completely dry, waterless kind of a cleaning, which is saving a lot of water, which is saving a lot of human effort, and the entire threat to because of local issues, etc. So technology is at play in everything that I just mentioned. And if you've been in touch with the local regulations, the latest regulation on forecasting and scheduling, today there are softwares which give you the irradiance data at that lat long, even without a pyranometer in place. That's called virtual irradiance, and there are a lot of companies which offer you that with accuracy as high as 99.6, 99.7%. And forecasting and scheduling demands that you give an accuracy which is as high as possible, because if you don't, then there is a penalty of anything between half a rupee to 1.5 rupees every unit that you get wrong in terms of your prediction. And mind you, your prediction has to be for the 15-minute block. So it's almost like you have to be right in every 15-minute blocks that you're forecasting your energy in. And there are many more things which are happening around us. And I don't think this panel discussion allows me to talk more about it, but I just wanted to give that flavor to the audience here that there's a lot going on, and I'm really hoping that more and more Indian companies get into it. Being the head of analytics here, what we are trying to do is we are trying to build in technology in everything that we are doing. I'm sure a lot of you've heard of the mobile lab that we've launched, which allows you to test modules on your site. You must have heard about cleaning robots that we are deploying at a few of our sites. I mean, there is a lot that we could probably discuss on technology.